what I would do is to start simply to talk about what are the tools that we use when we go down to work on the bees. And essentially there are really four that we use. One is a brush. One is, actually I have two different versions of what's a hive tool that we're going to work on. And this is that we use to pick things up, and I'll show you how that works. And then this is a smoker. That's a key part of what we do. And so since we're going to use it later, I'm going to start it now. And the way I've got wads of paper around here, and then I start that, put that down in there. And then actually, the purpose of the smoker really has two things it does. One of them is it makes the bees think that there's a fire, and so they think that they may have to abandon their hive, so they all go to start to load up on honey. And when they load up on honey, they're more docile. The second thing is they send out a scent when the hive has been opened up, and so this masks that scent, so all the bees don't know that the hive has been opened, and so there's, so we don't use this a whole lot, a few puffs. You're not trying to burn them or anything, but we're going to use that a little bit later. How do you get bees? And so really you buy bees and you get them in a box. They come in a box like this. You buy them by the pound, and so I get 3 pounds of bees, and 3 pounds of bees is about 10,000 bees. They ship them from warm places. I get mine through this person up in Wisconsin. He gets the orders for people in Wisconsin, Illinois. He ends up with about 10,000 orders for bees. 3 pounds of bees is 10,000 bees, so there's 100 million bees going through his place. So in here then are somewhere around 10,000 bees, and there's also a queen. And a queen comes in this, and so the queen is not related to the bees that we have here. And so we put her in here, and then we take her out, and we'll put her in the hive. So this has a cork in it when we get it. And then we take the cork out and we put in a marshmallow. And it takes about 3 days for the bees to eat through the marshmallow. And by that time, the queen scent is through the hive, and so they accept the queen. So this box, I probably didn't explain it. They put the queen in there, they dump it, and then this is a hole for a can of sugar water. So then they'll put this on a truck in California, they'll drive it all night, they'll get to Wisconsin, I go and pick it up, and then we put it in the hive. The queen comes in the box. So, you know, you get the box and you drop it and all the bees drop down, and you get her out, and then you put something over it so they all stay in there. And then I'll show you, we put the queen in the hive and we take this off and we dump the bees in there. There are three bees. There are three kinds of bees, three kinds of honeybees. There's the queen. The queen's about this big, about two knuckles. And then there's the drone, that's about a knuckle and a half. And then the worker bee, which is a female, unfertilized female, they do all the work. There's only one queen in a hive, and she will lay about, we'll get into some numbers here, she'll lay between 1,000 and 1,500 eggs a day. And that's all she does. The worker bees do different things. We'll talk about them in a moment. And then the drone doesn't do any work. That doesn't surprise you, I know. Doesn't have a stinger. The only reason there's a drone is to mate with the queen. And that happens once when she, now this is not this queen. This is a queen if we started and they were raising their own queen. Now we have a hive and this queen dies. Okay. They now are gonna raise their own queen. Okay. They're just gonna take one of the regular eggs, regular unfertilized female egg, and they feed it this special thing you've probably heard about, royal jelly, and that's a higher protein diet, and so she becomes a queen. Then she flies out on what's called her maiden flight, and she'll mate with these drones who normally are down at the bar, but they came home hoping they might find this, you know. So they mate with her. She may mate with more than one drone while she's out, but once she comes back to the hive, that's it. She doesn't do that again. She's fertile, and they can lay up to 2 million eggs. This queen dies, we were talking about, then they raise a queen. They'll take several eggs, they'll start to grow several different queens. The first one that hatches goes and kills the others. And then, yeah, good. And then goes and does her maiden flight and then comes back to the hive. Now, what could be bad at this point in time? It could be that a bird comes along and eats the queen. So, you know, then that's a problem for the hive, because then they don't have eggs and that. But hopefully the queen mates and comes back to the hive and lives a happy life for a couple of years. So this would be the opening where the bees would come. Now, in the 1850s, there was a person by the name of Langstroth who absolutely changed beekeeping. And what he created, what he found out, is that bees, there's a thing called a bee space, which is about 3/8 of an inch. If it's 3/8 of an inch, the bees won't close it up with wax. And so they built this, so these come out as though they were a file cabinet, but if you look, the spacing between these boards is about 3/8 of an inch. It allows you to, now they may build some wax in there, but allows you to take this out, do something with it, I'll show you that in a minute, and you put it back in. This allows you to, we put the queen in here, we can see if they're doing well, we can take it out, we put them back in, and that's that. But now we have a queen in here who's laying eggs. And so we want to keep the queen in here. This is called a queen excluder. So these wires are small enough, or big enough that the worker bee can get through, but small enough that the queen can't. So it goes on like this. So now she's going to stay down there, but the worker bees can go up. Now the reason bees make honey is to, so they'll have food through the winter time, but they make more than they need. So we put on then, on top of this, we'll put on a honey section. And now it's the same thing, but these have been built out and they've been reused. So going back to the nature of the hive, and we'll show you, we're gonna take three of these out when we get down there with the bees, and we're gonna spin them, but you take this out, it's full of honey, you have a hot knife and you slice off the, and then you spin it. Do the same thing on the other side. And we'll see that in a minute. But again, 3/8, although we do take advantage of the bees in an interesting way, and instead of having 10 of those, we put 9. And the reason we put 9 is that it allows them to build out a little bit more honey. So when we go to take the knife off, it's a lot easier to get it off. So you get the same amount of honey, actually might even get more. It just makes it easier. So we're gonna take out 3 down there like this. So then the last thing that we put on is essentially what's called a top board. And then on top of that, we'll have a lid. I don't have a lid up here, but. And that's essentially the hive. But the breakthrough on honey, the breakthrough was this, figuring out this bee space, and then the people invented this so you can take them out and put them back in. Right. Now here's, and this, it's in the paper, what is crazy about this is the large numbers. So a bee, from the time it's an egg to the time it dies is about 9 weeks. It's in the bee stage of the egg, the larva, the pupa, and hatching as 21 days. And then it's a nurse bee. It takes care of the queen, it takes care of the other, it cleans up the hive. And then the last 3 weeks, primarily, it's a field bee. It's out gathering stuff. The nature of a larva is there's 5 days in here where it's a larva and it has to be fed. And they say it's fed 10,000 times. So there's 5,000 larvae at any one time times 10,000. So there's like 50 million in the, so each day there's about, all these workers are feeding larvae 10 million times. That's a lot of work.
Yeah.
That's a lot of work. But when we get down there, these hives right now, I sent Corinne a picture last night, it was so hot they were outside, but there's probably a couple of those hives down there are 80,000 bees. So when we open up the hive, we're gonna see a lot of bees, okay? We're gonna see a lot of bees. So anyway, I wanted to explain the hive because this is a breakthrough. It changed the nature of honey, or changed the nature of beekeeping. And then almost everything now is based on this worldwide. There are other themes and variations, but by and large, this is the most popular, the most efficient. Clearly, the easiest to work with. This is an incentive program. You want them to have enough room to make honey, but not too much room so they get demoralized. So I start with one of these boxes. And then, depending on the nectar flow, I have seen them fill one of these boxes in 3 weeks. So one pound of honey, I got these statistics in there. I think bees fly like 55,000 miles to get one bottle of honey, something like 2 million flowers. So each bottle of honey is the life of roughly 700 bees. I think this year I'm gonna get 500 pounds of honey. A lot of work by those guys. So, Tara, so they come along and I look at this to say, okay, it's about 70% fill, I'll put another one on. What I did this year, and I don't know if it's gonna work, but I decided I didn't wanna put three on, so I've been taking these out and spinning them. And then I put them back in. You're gonna slice this off and then you put this in a centrifuge and to spin the honey out. And then you put it back in the hive, and then they clean it up. They only make honey when there's nectar.
Okay.
And they only make nectar when there's flowers. There are professional beekeepers. They start in Florida with the orange blossoms. They move to Georgia for the peach blossoms. They move north for the apple blossoms. They end up moving out to North Dakota with all the clover. So they're moving their bees, and then they take them back to Florida for the wintertime. But Corinne's from California. The almond industry in California is 3 times more valuable than the wine business. And they end up, they need honeybees to pollinate the almond trees. And they'll end up somewhere about 30 to 40% of all the honeybees in the United States are out in California the 3 or 4 weeks that the almond trees are blooming. And it's down there in the valley. I have not been there when it's in, but there's like 6,000 square miles, and every acre has to have, they try to have 4 of these hives, so it's crazy. This black box, so we're gonna show you cappings down here, and then after you get done, I put it out, the bees take as much honey out, they clean it up, and then you put it in here, and it melts the wax. We were talking about swarming, and that's how I got interested. That's how I got involved in bees. I came home from high school, and there was a swarm of bees in the yard. This goes back a few years ago, and my dad and I got those. And so I kept them pretty much till I started college. And then after college, I think I've been keeping bees probably now, I don't know, from 1975 on, and I've moved them to several different states. I put them in the back of a truck, take them with me. We were talking about the beginning of the hive. So you actually, they make this. This is the foundation. So you put this in the hive. So this is wax that's printed, and then you put that in there. So they start they start building from that. I mean, they would do it themselves, but this allows you to jumpstart. In addition, it has wire in there that gives it some support. Very rarely.
Very rarely.
Okay. And if it is, it's, I've made a mistake. So I can get stung. I would say if you asked, I'm down there, I've got, and a bee lands there and I do that. So it'll sting me, but it doesn't leave the stinger there. So I just get a little bit of a sting. And then earlier this spring, I was down there and I was trying to do something. I had gloves on and then I took my gloves off. And then I put my gloves back on, but there was a bee in the glove. So that didn't work out real well. But if you ever get stung by a honeybee, they die when they sting you because the venom sac is there. You want to scrape that off. You don't want to do that. Because if you do it like that, you're going to squeeze all the venom into your arm. So you take like a little knife or a credit card and you pry it out without squeezing that sac. You want the sun to hit the hive early in the morning. So this catches all the east sun. And then what he also would like is have it in the shade in the afternoon because it's so hot. And at night if you watch, they get down the bottom and half of them are fanning air in and half of them are fanning air out. And it's trying to cool things down. So essentially, nectar is about one-third honey and about two-thirds water. So there is a chemical process, but essentially a lot of it is just evaporation. I read that honeybees can tell colors, and if you just have all white hives out here, they sort of drip. So I said, well, what the heck this year? I'm going to put colored disc on each of the hives, and I got a colored disc, and then I got a landing area for them. I don't know, there's no way to tell if that scientifically works or not, but it was fun. So there's the yellow and blue and red. Each box has its own queen. Well, it'll be 80,000. These probably, the third and fourth, probably have 80,000 each. So,
condominium.
Yeah, well, if you think about it, let's just say 60,000 times 8, so almost 500,000 bees. So here's a queen excluder, this thing here, those wires to keep her from going up, and then I put these on here because there's so many bees here. I don't know what this hive is doing, but I have three boxes on there. Other than that, I've been trying not to get three boxes just because it's a lot of work. The other thing somebody asked we didn't talk about, they also paint the queen. On the top of her back, there's little, they can put a dab of paint. So you were asking, can you find the queen? That's how you can find her. But she's down in here. We're not going to anyway see the queen now. She's down below. Actually, she's one that was inseminated and sent to us, okay?
She's a mail order bride.
She's a mail order bride, but if one of them has died, and I wouldn't necessarily know, then they would be doing what you talked about. They would have mated and come back. She flies, and hopefully she can find her way home. So the way I've got this set up is there are three frames of honey right here on this side that we're going to take out.
The little
file cabinet. So what we do is we're just going to give them so they know we're here. We're going to pop this. So the other thing I made last year is I made this to put it on top. It allows more air. So this whole thing is hot air coming up. So I put these holes in it and they seem to like it. At least that's what they tell me. All right, so when I do this, they're all gonna run down the middle. You can all come back here, more to the back. So we're gonna give them a little smoke and see what they do. We'll start or not. Okay, ladies.
These are all ladies.
all ladies. Well, right now they should hope that something's on fire and they should be going. Let's see what's going on. So.
I've never been around so many bees.
Yeah, well, this is when we open up, okay? So again, we just want them to know we're here. I think they know it. So I mentioned there are 9 of these in here instead of 10. I've spun these 6 already, but I haven't spun these 3. So we're gonna take them out. I'm gonna take them out and I'm gonna put them in that box. For the meantime, just as a holding pen, that seemed to work better. And I've got my, now I didn't invent this and I didn't show this to you, but I wish I had. This is a neat little thing that you slide this under and it's little got a little fulcrum on it.
Oh, to lower it out.
Yeah, so why didn't I invent that, right? So that fits under there and then we're gonna pull this up. They built this wax on top, but they have not built the whole thing with wax. But these are full of honey. Yeah, probably. Probably 5 pounds. So it's not so heavy as you have to be careful. So you can see the white wax. Combination of wax and honey, but when they get it all, when they actually built their, they built this cell so it has a slight upward slope. And then they fill it up and cap it as they go along. So that's the first one.
And do they get? Is it because of the smoke they're less agitated if you were to do this? Do they get agitated?
No.
Yeah.
The key thing is be quiet. I mean, if I hit against this hive right now, they'd be buzzing. But so far we smoked them and we haven't done anything untoward yet. Yeah, honey. Well, let's pull one more out. We'll pull the last one out here. So Corinne, to answer your question, you don't want them to do this, but you'll see they have actually have built up honey down there below, between the one box and the next. So you'd like that not to have happened, but it has. So now.
How do you get that out? Or
yeah, that's a great question. So I did this yesterday and they had done not this high, but a lot. So by the time I went up and spun and brought it back, they will have gotten all that honey out of there and it'll just be the wax. I took this out about a week and a half ago. Well, they haven't sealed it up, but they have, you won't be able to see it here, Catherine, but there's a lot of honey in this thing. It's pretty heavy. So, yeah. So I'd say it's almost 2/3 full. But they really build from the center, they work from the center out. The question is, how do we get the bees off the honey, right?
Yeah, right.
That's the question. So what I'm gonna do is normally I get these back here tonight, but I don't think I am. So I'm gonna take these three that we were talking about up there, and I'm gonna stick them in there overnight. So a little bit helps. There's no comb on the bottom, so I don't think I'm gonna kind of crush them so much.
These will only return to this condominium. They won't go to any other of the body. They belong to this structure.
There is a, so the last phase of the field bee, they become a guard bee. Wow. And so a bee coming in here will have the scent of the hive from which she came. Now, there is some drifting, but by and large, they're supposed to come back. And that's why I put the color thing on it, because I really do think that helps them go back to the right hive. Who knows? But other than that, there is drifting. So if there's one or two or three bees, that won't be. But if you leave honey out in the summertime, you get it busy, and then there's a thing starts called robbing, and then they start trying to rob each other, and that's a real mess, because now you got thousands of bees trying to get into the weaker hives, and it's really hard to stop that. It has happened, and so then you start try to reduce the size of the entrance by putting a stick or other things in there. I can show you some. So there's a little hole there, you see that? It's right there, they can come in. Yeah, they can come in and out. And again, this is that bee space. So we got that, put that back on.
Can you talk a little bit about the bee game?
Yeah. Bees can tell direction, they say, they've got five eyes, but they see polarized light, and they orient themselves to the sun. If they find a source of nectar, they will come back to the hive and do a dance that says, this is the direction, and this is the distance from the hive. And so they're doing a spinning in there. What's amazing is it's in the dark. I mean, it's dark in here, right? It's dark. So they hear it. But, so you know, I talked about taking I take the cappings off this and I put them over there behind the house. Now that's 200 feet, turning right. So one bee will come, and then a little bit later, a lot of bees will be there. So they can communicate distance and direction.
Will your bees ever make it through the winter?
They should make it. I've had good years and I've had bad years. One year I had 7 hives and I got 6 through. Last year I just grinned. Heard me say I didn't make any through. So there's two things about it. First of all, you're working on two different equations. One is you want to go into the wintertime with enough bees so that they cluster up and they stay warm. Because inside the hive, in the middle of those bees, is like 95 degrees. So you got a lot of bees, and then you want to have enough food. So if you got too many bees and not enough food, or not enough bees. But what happened right at Halloween last year, the bees are in the hive. I have insulated these hives with insulation board. I wrap them with tar paper. But it was still early in the year. They're spread out through the hive. There's a lot of moisture in there, and it got really cold. So now the moisture freezes up, drops on the bees, and they all died. Mine died, and everybody I talked to lost their bees like in November. Normally, if it works well, I can get half of them through. But again, if I don't, I mean, worst case, then I start over. And so then people say, you know, how much does that cost? I think that package is like, with the queen, is I think like $140 or $150. I mean, it's not a lot of money. This is a bee escape. So this is the top, and then the bees go down through here. And on the other side, they come out on these cones. And so in 24 hours, you can get almost all the bees out of here and they don't get back in. If you left it there for a week, they'd figure out how to get in. What's amazing, yes, so I'll take, that'll be full of bees. I'll take them all out, I'll put this in, I'll put that back on. The next day, there are almost no bees in here at all. My theory has been by putting over here, they've kind of loaded up a little bit on honey. And what I absolutely don't want to do is drop this thing, which has happened once or twice in my life. It just makes a mess. That wasn't too bad. Andy, you want to do this?
What do you like most about beekeeping?
I do a lot of management stuff, and the one thing that fascinates me, I tell people, is self-directed work groups. I mean, there are 1,000 bees hatching every day. How do they know what they're supposed to do, right? 3 weeks in there doing the nursing and feeding and all the larva feeding and cleaning and everything, and then out here. So to me, it's just amazing how 80,000 insects can get so organized and clean. They're walking over this stuff every day, thousands of bugs, and yet they figure out how to make this thing work, and it is very complicated. So complicated that there are two mathematical proofs on a question. The first question is, what geometric objects come together so there's no space in the corners, right? So what would those be? Square, triangles, and a hexagon. Second question is, of a geometric object with a fixed perimeter, what's the shape that has the most, so you have a minimum perimeter to get the maximum area? The answer there is a circle. But the closest thing to a circle is a hexagon. So they've figured out how to minimize the amount of wax they have to make to store the maximum amount of honey.
Have you noticed anything that you plant in your yard or things around you that make healthier hives? Like, is it native flowers? Is it wildflowers? Is it, you know, sunflowers?
So let's talk about where bees find honey. A bee will fly up to 5 miles.
In a day?
On each trip.
Okay.
Theoretically. So if you take the radius of 5 miles and you work the math, it's 75 square miles that they can essentially find stuff. So it's amazing to me where they do find it out here, but if you go down the road here about a mile, there's a place called the Heller Park. They have somewhere around 20 beehives. They're doing some community projects. And so they can find it, and this is a collection of all sorts of things. I like to plant things I like, but as I showed Corinna earlier, I've got somewhere like probably over 1,000 feet of linear feet of sunflowers out here. And the first ones bloomed today, came out. But I did that because they like sunflowers and I like sunflowers. But part of this is mowed and part of it isn't. There's a lot of clover in here. There's a lot of wildflowers. So they just collect a lot of different things. But why bees are such good pollinators is on each trip, by and large, they only go to that kind of a flower. So if I'm in the garden, we've got a lot of zinnias. They will go to zinnias of different colors, but they will go to the zinnias. If they go to the melons, they stay with the melons. And so what is happening is they're getting the pollen on their body and they go from one flower to the next, and that's how the pollination occurs. And what people say is that really about a third of our food comes because of the pollination of bees. And as we talked a little bit earlier about the almonds in California, if they didn't have bees, they would essentially get very few almonds. They haven't figured out yet. I mean, I know they're trying to figure out how can we pollinate this without honeybees, because that's a big expense. But honeybees are by far the best pollinators that anybody knows about. There are other bees, there are butterflies, there are things like that, but no place do they visit 55,000 flowers, you know, 2 million flowers. 2 million flowers to make a pound of honey, that's a lot of pollination. The primary value of honeybees is pollination of a variety of crops. And if crops are pollinated, you get a third more produce than you do if they aren't. So you start with the orange blossoms in Florida, and that's a 2 weeks. And then they load the bees on a truck, and they drive them overnight. They get to Georgia, and now it's peach blossoms, and they're there for 2 weeks. And then, boom, they do something, and they go up to, let's say, the melons in New Jersey in another 2 weeks. So at each of those points, those beekeepers are being paid somewhere around $150 to put their hive there to pollinate the crop. That's about what they get on almonds. So Corinne was asking what happened to this thing called the colony collapse disorder. And it was called a disorder because people didn't really know. And primarily the people that were having the problem were the professional beekeepers. But think about this now. You're in Florida with the orange blossoms. They only have one kind of a diet, right? And they may get pesticides. And then they put them on a truck and they bounce them and bounce them and bounce them, and then they unload them into another place. So that put a lot of stress on them. The diet was not the best because it was just one source. But the biggest problem for honeybees is a thing that's called, and it's you can look this up, I think maybe there's a reference. It's called a varroa, V-A-R-R-O-A, mite. It came in the United States about 1985, and the varroa mite gets into the cell when the egg is laid and it sucks the juice out of the bee. So when the bee hatches, it's in a weakened state. We don't have a cure for that yet. We are now putting strips of things that are hard on the varroa mite, but you can't do it when they're making honey. So what I do is I put that strip in there. When I get these bees, I put the strip in there and I take it out and leave it for a week before I put this on. You know, I take this off in September, I'll put that back in. You need to leave those strips in there for about 42 days. It's about two birth cycles of the bees, 21 days, 21 days.
You have problems with the varroa?
Everybody has problems with the varroa mite. It weakens the bee, then they can get a virus, they can get this, they can get that. So it's like the COVID-19 to honeybees. It may kill them, but if they're in a weakened state, it sure makes it tougher. So yes, part of the reason I think we lose bees is we can't kill all the mites. So the big problem for the end of the year is yellow jackets.
Uh-huh.
So a yellow jacket attacks, and so it takes a lot of bees to get rid of a yellow jacket. So I do too. So I try to, by September, I will reduce the size of that entrance. In the fall, problem are skunks.
Oh. Yeah.
And so the skunks will come up here. I mean, now we're, by and large, we're inside, it's getting cold. And the skunks will come here and start scratching, and they scratch, and then the bees come out, and then they eat the bees.
It doesn't bother them to be stung?
Well, I don't know if they get stung. That's what's fascinating. I don't know. I know they eat them. So there are lots of places where the bears attack the beehives, and people think it's because they want the honey, but a lot of it is they're after the larva. They're after the protein that they would get from the larva. But if bees come in, most places where there are bees, they put electric fences around their beehives, their bee yard, to keep the bears out. And so it's a high fence and it's electrified, because bears, they will just come in, and stinging them doesn't bother them. I mean, you can see them, they have mouthfuls of bees, and however that works, it doesn't bother them, but they would just knock all this stuff over and it'd just be a mess. Well, probably the challenge is to get them through the winter, because I work really hard to try and do that, so because I really would like, I mean, they've worked really hard, and I've worked hard, and so I'm trying to make sure they get through. So when they don't, you feel bad, because now in September, I will start to feed sugar water. They take a jar and there's holes in the top, you put it, and they'll take a lot of that sugar water. And then I also have on the top in the wintertime, instead of this board, I have another board in there that's called a sugar board. I've taken sugar and I liquefied it and lightly, and I spread it out. So now it's caked sugar, and that's another source of food for them. And then on top of that, I have another hive that, or another box, and I put shredded paper in there. You want the bees to stay warm, but you don't want the moisture. So you've got to have a flow of air. And so these shredded paper, they'll soak up the water. And I'll change that paper about every 2 weeks, just on the top. I don't open the box. I just open the top, take it out, and put in the other. So the challenge is getting it through the winter. This is a heater that I heat it just enough to make it a lot easier to bottle.
Got it. Mm-hmm.
Some people drive it up really high, like the stuff you see in the store, they drive up high, so it takes out the enzymes that cause the sugar. But sugaring is a natural process of good honey. So when we get finished tonight, there are, each of these is probably 3.5 pounds. So there's at least 10 pounds of honey there. Okay, so that's 10 bottles. And I really worried about whether I should be doing it more than just, normally at the end of August, I do it all in about 3 days. That's why I gotta use that bee excluder and everything to get them down out of there. But this way I just, you know, I can do a 2 or 3. You saw they didn't really get that excited tonight, right?
Yeah,
we would
right.
agree.
Yeah, right.
I mean, we'd agree that, you know, I could have gone out there without anything on. I never do that because I probably get stung.
Yeah.
The funny guys are these old guys. You got to be a beekeeper. You got to have the beard. You have to have a big belly, and you smoke a cigar, because then they use the cigar smoke like the, they blow that smoke on them, and then the bees do whatever they're supposed to do. So, assuming everything here is good, we're just going to take one of these. And I lay it up here on this board like this. And then what I want to do is I want to take this off, because this is pretty hard wax. So I take that off. And then it goes in there. And it's going to go from here to there to there. Okay. And the other thing you remember we mentioned is by making 9 of these, they would build out a little bit more past the wood. That makes it a lot easier to do. So we're going to take this knife that's pretty sticky with honey.
And it's been soaking in hot water?
It's been soaking in water. It's cool water.
Cool water.
Because I don't want it to be too hot. I don't want it to melt the wax. I just want it to cut it off, okay? So, assuming everything works right. And then you don't. We take this little thing and we open it up. All right.
I'm left-handed.
Oh, no! That ends that. Or can you do it backhanded?
Okay, let me see if I can kind of go this way.
Oops. Not too deep.
Too deep? Okay.
Back and forth.
And then?
Yeah, then dump it.
Then dump it.
That's it. Easy. Back and forth. Not too, yeah, easy.
Like
just
that?
One. Yeah,
okay.
Back and this way.
Like that?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Dump it.
It is.
Now don't, yeah, you're,
oh, not yeah. too, okay, sorry.
Up a little bit, there you go. Now
like
you're,
this.
Now you're getting it.
Okay.
Up high. That's what it was, and this is what it is. Okay, now that goes in here.
What is,
it's
like a centrifuge?
It's a centrifuge, but we're going to put three of them in. That's why
okay.
we got three, because that makes it balanced.
Then it's all gooey, you can, you know.
Yeah, it's interesting how this beeswax could be really, really soft and really hard. Like when she's taking off that top, it's really hard.
So from here, does it go in here?
It goes in here.
Oh, here.
And then it opens here and it goes through this, it strains it.
Okay.
So, you know, it's got a lot of wax and stuff on it now, you'll
right.
see. So it strains and so. I've got
Should
two
I
of these.
It over and do the hard stuff?
Yep. And then so I'd get that, and then you can see here there's a. The one the reason you want to sit a little bit, you can see there's a little bit of wax there on top.
Mm-hmm.
So I will bring that over and scoop it out.
Okay.
So you let it sit for a couple days.
Okay.
But by then it's cool, and so
okay.
it's hard to bottle.
Oh,
so
you have to heat it up.
That's so you heat it up a little bit so you get.
Does it ever, like, does it re-solidify or whatever?
Honey will, not here, but honey will solidify. Good honey will solidify if it gets to a low temperature. Put it in here. The other way. Over there in that corner. That's it. You don't have to go fast. We're going to go 100 times. Not too fast. Not too fast. Not too fast. Not too fast. There you go. Keep going. Because if you get too fast, see, the honey on the other side will break the comb.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you can go a little faster, but it's not a race. Okay, I think that's good.
Okay.
Yeah, the opposite way?
No.
No, we have to spin them, right? Or rotate them?
Yes, exactly. Got to get the other side out.
Okay.
So.
You're a theory.
So that's the side that's been spun.
Yeah, it looks a lot lighter.
Can you see it?
Yeah, I'm gonna get pretty close.
All right.
Can you put
and now, here's the side that hasn't been spun.
Ah.
Much different.
Yeah.
And Corinne, you remember those wires we talked about?
Yeah.
Can you see them in there? Can you see the wires?
Yeah.
Because if you go real, real fast, you got all this weight on this side now and none on the other side. You can actually cause it. No, you didn't do it. It didn't break anything. So now we got to have this on the outside. So we turn it like that. Okay. So that's the spun the side we spun. So we want it like so. Now it'll coast. It'll coast 5. You can let go. Perfect.
Okay.
You want the job? I mean, now we're doing 3 of these. We got 900 to go.
Yes.
Whoa.
Whoa.
Look at that. Wow. Is this just from the three? These are just all from the three. There was so much honey still left on those after we scraped it off.
I know.
Well, you didn't scrape off the honey. We're scraping off the cappings.
The cappings, but there's still honey in the cappings.
But there is
a lot of honey in the cappings. Now, if you listen, you can hear it dripping through.
And then this goes through the strainer.
It's going through the strainer now.
Okay.
Okay.
And then when it sits through the strainer, you put it in the
baker. We put it in here then?
I mean, I'd lift this thing up and then I just flip it like that, and then I got a stick there that I stick in here, and I leave it in there to drain for a while.
Okay.
Like that.
It's amazing.
Honey's the only food that people get from insects.
Oh.
And secondly, honey doesn't spoil. It will crystallize, but that's not spoiling. Then you just warm it. The other day, I was taking this right out of the hive. It was like 90 degrees, and I took I've never had 90 degree honey. It was unbelievably good.
It was so good.
Really good.